Everybody talks about how great the RV life is.
Well, we are going to talk about the downsides. I'm Liz.
And I'm Paul. And these are exciting times to push past fear, build confidence, and live amazing.
And you definitely need to push past fear if you're thinking about hitting the road, particularly if you're thinking about selling your house, selling all your possessions, and just RVing full time. Well, Paul and I love this life, but we know it's not for everyone. And there are some downsides. And while we're fine with the downsides, they might be a stopper for you.
This life is not a bed of roses.
It's not bad.
It has its challenges.
So we're going to do a countdown. We're going to go from bad to worse. But we don't want this to be a downer. If you are thinking about this life, this may help you. If you're already on the road, let us know what your downsides are. And again, we're not complaining. We just want you to go into this life with your eyes wide open. All right, so number six is mail.
This is kind of a big one, even though it's the first one on our list, not the worst one on our list by far. We have to have our mail forwarded to an address. And what makes it so difficult is that not all of the parks will accept mail. That means that you have to have it sent general delivery to a post office in the town that you're closest to.
And not all post offices accept general delivery.
That's the other part.
And then the other thing is just trying to get things shipped to us, not just our mail forwarded, but when we order things, we're always trying to time, well, how long is it going to take? And we arrived at a park and we were there for a couple days and we said, let's go on. But wait, we can't, right?
Yeah.
Because we're waiting for a package and we had to stay another 5 days just to wait for that. So it's kind of an ongoing sort of pain.
One of the things that happened to us during the lockdown is we had a problem with the new rig. I called Grand Design and they were going to send the part out to us, but it showed up a day after we had left the park.
We ended up paying somebody $50 to simply take that package from the campground office, drive it a mile and a half to the UPS office. I mean, it was crazy, but it was the only way we could be sure it would be done.
Number five is that you're going to give up something that you had in your sticks and bricks house or home that you can't bring with you. In my case, it was my garage. If you're a regular viewer of this channel, you know that I built hot rods in my garage. I certainly can't do that out here on the road. And so I had to give up all my welding equipment, most of my tools. I brought some tools, but most of my tools were left behind.
And for me, it was giving up the kitchen and what I needed to entertain and just those things. So if you're thinking about doing this life, there's sort of a constant warning of, oh, I used to have that. I had that in my former life, you know? We'll be cooking a special meal and I'll remember some little gadget. Oh, I used to have it, but I don't have it. He'll be fixing something and be realizing he used to have a tool that he doesn't have. Number four is laundry. This is kind of a constant pain. In my former life, if I got maybe some chocolate on my shirt, I just tossed it in the washer and I had a delicate cycle so I could take better care of my clothes. Now laundry is a process, right?
The rig that we're in, it is set up for a washer dryer, but we chose not to get one. And I don't see that we're going to get one in the future. Mm-hmm. So that means we go to laundromats.
So that can take a couple hours. We have to get used to the different type of laundromats that we go to as to how they work, how big the machines are. And some of the machines may be not so nice to our clothes. So our clothes wear out quicker. I'm finding that I have less nice clothes. I'm gonna be buying more more utilitarian clothes and less pretty fancy delicate clothes.
Yeah.
And even if you're on the road and you decide, okay, I'm gonna have a washer and dryer in the rig, that has its own downsides too. Each load can take 3 or 4 hours. They take forever to dry. They can shake the whole rig. Water access can be a problem. Hard to do if you're boondocking or if you don't have sewer, then the water in your gray tank fills up. So even that is not a perfect solution.
Yeah, I would say that if you're not connected to a sewer, doing laundry in the rig is virtually impossible. I mean, you're going to fill up your gray tank with a couple of loads.
And I've heard the spin cycle will just shake the whole rig. It's loud, and of course they're small machines, so you may only be able to do one sheet, not both sheets at a time. So have you ever heard that saying, wherever you go, there you are? Well, whoever you're traveling with, there they are.
And there's no escaping.
There's
maybe
no...
maybe that's the wrong...
It's okay, because there really is. You know, you're used to having your she shed, your garage, your man cave. There's no escape.
There are none of that. There's none of that out here. I mean, you can go for a walk in the woods. I mean, we're in a beautiful wooded area, and we could, you know, you could certainly go out and
yeah, and go
get
out
away for an hour or so.
Right, but now think about it being a rainy day. You're stuck inside with whoever you're traveling with. How would you feel about that? Because you really have to get along well with your partner or your family or whoever.
This is not a life to try to heal a wounded relationship.
It might work. When you're together with your partner or your family in a small space, it really intensifies your relationship, and it can really bring out the worst if you're not careful. So you really need to have good skills as far as communicating and getting past conflict, and also have individual interests, right? So that you're not on top of each other all the time.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, we have a story for you. Tell about that guy that we met.
Yeah, we were wandering around out for a walk, and saw this beautiful 45-foot diesel pusher with tag axle. I mean, it was
Class A.
It was a beautiful Class A.
Yeah.
And we were admiring it, and the fellow that owned it came out and started chatting with us. And one of the first things he told us about the rig and the reason that they got such a large rig is he said, I just wanted to be as far away from my wife as possible.
And as it turned out, they actually had it up for sale. They had tried this life for a year, and not for them.
Yep, they were going back to sticks and bricks.
Well, this might be a good place to talk about advice. If you are thinking about this life, there's a way you can try it.
Yeah, I would suggest getting a rental.
Yeah, you can rent from private parties as well as big companies, but try out the life before selling the house.
Yeah, I was just reading on a Fulltime RVer page on Facebook of a couple that rented an RV for the first time, and it was a disaster of a trip. They broke down, they had a blowout, couldn't get roadside assistance. They called roadside assistance, they never showed up. I mean, it was just one problem after another.
Wherever you are, there's going to be stress, there's going to be problems. It's just how well can you handle it, and are you in the right environment, the right lifestyle for you where you can get past it? Number two is a big one for me. I probably would put this at number one, and it's lack of community. Going on the road for me meant giving up my community, my circle of friends, my spiritual center, just all those social connections, even, you know, the gals I did yoga with, all that went away. And what I noticed was I would go to a grocery store anywhere on the road and I would think, I'm not going to run into anyone that I know. I'm just all alone out here. Of course, I have Paul, but it's that lack of community that really makes me sad. And if you are thinking about going on the road, just think about how much social you need. Now, the good part about it is that slowly we are developing a social life on the road where we're meeting people that we've met before and we are building friendships. It takes a lot longer than if we were in one place and then they were in one place, but I do feel like there is hope to build community.
Yeah, it's not like you can just pick up the phone and say, hey, let's meet for lunch somewhere, because they're probably in another state. For me, my community was the hot rod world, and I was pretty active in it. I would take my car to show at least once a week, and I knew a lot of the guys with hot rods, so, you know, hanging out with them was fun, and that's all gone.
Another answer to this would be to travel with friends so that you do get to do more group activities if that's what you want.
And if you're thinking of doing this life solo, both of us did that. We were both solo for a year before we met and started traveling together. Just know that this life can be very isolating, and isolation can certainly lead to depression. So just know that. Go in with your eyes open.
Yeah, you just need to work a little harder at making connections with others if you're by yourself.
And you might be perfectly fine with that. I have friends that are very into their alone time. One friend in particular, he could spend months out by himself and he would be just fine.
Right, and that's another thing. If you know that you need other people, campgrounds are really friendly places. If you don't want community, then just go out in the boonies.
And the worst one for us, the number one issue for us, especially for me, is lack of internet. We have a Verizon plan, and it really doesn't matter what you have. You're going to have, there's going to be dead spots around the country.
No cell service means no internet. Yeah.
Yep. Nothing.
Yeah. And that's typical. So if you want to go camping not in an urban area, likely it will be that you don't have service. And of course, you know, we have a YouTube channel, right? So we do need service for that. But just for entertaining ourselves, what do you need the internet for?
Well, I use it for, I watch a lot of YouTube videos, not the ones that we produce, but just a lot of
Well, of course you watch them too.
Well, I watch those too. But I watch a lot of, you know, bicycle races on that are that are dropped onto YouTube. It's my source of entertainment. I don't watch much television, and that's another thing. You don't get a lot of television. I see a lot of people, and we haven't done this, so I'm not an expert in this by any means. But I see a lot of people with portable satellite dishes,
the
little dome things. I guess you get a lot of channels that way.
Oh, and I've been to parks where people have said that even with their dome, no TV. So if TV is important for you, internet's important for you, this is something to know. And if you're out there and you have found a way to have internet everywhere or cell service everywhere, please let us know. We need that big time. We have moved from campgrounds. We have moved from campsites just to get service because it's a big deal, particularly for Paul.
Yeah, the site that we're in right now, we moved from another site that's a stone's throw from here, but we found that there's limited internet.
One bar of internet. We went from like half a bar to one bar. And
no coverage to some coverage.
Right. And you know, for us, this is our life. It is not a vacation. So we do need regular access to internet. It's not like, oh, let's just take a weekend and be unplugged. We're out here full time. And we realize that internet is part of what we want.
So what are your downsides to RV living? Leave them in the comments below.
And we'll see you in the next video.